I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice. I mean, listen, we're talking about practice. Not a game. We're talking about practice. Yes. Not a game.
Me. Bam, bam. Me, man.
Not a game.
Slap that place, you score 30.
We talking about sports. I mean, what we even talking about, man? We talking about sports here.
All right, guys. This is episode 42. This is the Jackie Robinson episode, if you will. The We Talking About Sports podcast. As always, it's Roland here with you. We got Big Papa Doge. If you're looking at us on YouTube, got Ben's little profile name, and we're joined by a special guest today, Mr. Richie Cantu. Richie, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Hey, I've known the guys for a minute, so we go way back. I'm in Austin currently. I'm a big sports fan, range from basketball, football, baseball, soccer. We're huge soccer fans, so it's an honor to be on the pod. Appreciate it, guys.
Teams that you root for, obviously the Spurs.
Spurs, Cowboys, Astros, Texas Tech Red Raiders, West Ham United in the EPL. Barcelona in La Liga, and Tigres in Liga MX.
Hell yeah. This guy's a sports almanac when it comes to soccer. If you want to know something, this is my go-to guy. I know Ben always asks Richie in our group, too, if there's going to be a high-scoring game going on. He's kind of the soccer guy in our group. He's the soccer aficionado, so we're glad to have him on here because we got some Champions League talk to get to in a little bit. But yeah. Before we get into the sports, Ben – why don't you give the people a little bit of a breakdown, Mr. Musk, Ben Musk over here.
Dude, you know me, man. Just been pumping Dogecoin all week. Not as much as Wally. I'm not getting as many tweets off as Wally, but I'm in second place, I would say. Dude, my week has literally consisted of watching this stupid coin and fucking day baseball, I guess. That's literally been it. Ready for the weekend. Got some weekend plans for Gabby's birthday. Got some people coming up here. We're going to head out to the wineries and to Salt Lake. So the weekend should be fun, man. But happy to be back after that Facebook Live podcast edition that we had.
Shit, I know, yeah.
Justin said it got taken down off YouTube for copyright infringement.
Oh, because we had the draft playing?
Yeah, this fool wants to be all high tech and show people the draft on our video, even though everybody's watching it on the TV. So we did get cracked for that, but the audio version was still good. But yeah, man, last week's podcast was pretty fun. I know we're going to get into the draft a little bit later, but happy to be back and happy to have Rich here too.
Yeah, we had a big reveal last week too, with you coming out as a Bills fan.
Yeah.
Last week, so how does it? I mean, you got 1 week under your belt.
Dude, I have people telling me like, nah, that ain't gonna happen around me. Like, like if I'm coming into somebody's hood and trying to establish territory. Nah.
Then hey, you're not the only one too. One of my other friends, you know her, India. She played in the fantasy football league with us. She hopped shit from the Texans also. I tried talking shit to her about the Texans.
Joby did as well.
She wasn't having it.
Joby did as well. At some point, everybody has a breaking point. And listen, I know you all are Cowboys fans, so you've been through some of the lows, but at least your owner is out there about, you know, actively trying to get players and not shipping them off, you know?
For sure.
So like I said, I have no jersey I can wear. I'm going to try and flip all my Texans caps and then get some money to buy some Bills gear, you know, maybe a Josh Allen jersey and shit. But
bro,
none of my jerseys are worth shit anymore, Rich. They became throwbacks.
You got to get that number 17.
Hey, bro, at least the Bills retro, all their vintage gear is like so sick. Not to mention, they're very exciting to watch, you know, passionate fan base.
They're dildos on the field.
Well, you're going to have to get a garbage plate, bro.
Hey, I was looking at some of their vintage gear on like Mercari and Poshmark on the apps. Like, I was looking for some hats, bro. And I mean, they have old school shit.
And they're sick, bro.
Yeah.
So I'm super stoked because they picked one of my dudes from Texas Tech. Man, the guy's a killer guard. He's gonna do. I think he's gonna be quite the catch, man. He's a stud.
Oh yeah. Well, we're gonna get into that. We're gonna do a Bills and a Cowboys draft breakdown here in a little bit, but. Myself, much like Ben, I've been watching some stock tickers. I wish the rest of my portfolio would look like Doge right now, but it is what it is. I'm taking my victories where I can get them. And I've just been, you know, glued to this NBA playoff race. I've been betting basketball almost every day, it seems like, and baseball is getting into the swing. So, yeah, man, I'm excited. Ben, I might hit you up this weekend. I don't know if I'll be there for Salt Lake, but I definitely plan on making my way up there.
We're coming back to the house after for the Canelo fight. So,
Hell yeah. Well, is it true? Speaking of Canelo, we'll get into a little bit of MMA later, but did Billy Joe Saunders, is he fighting still?
He didn't show up to the first face-off that was supposed to take place, I believe, Monday due to disagreements with the ring size. Canelo's camp wanted a smaller ring, and Billy Joe Saunders wanted the bigger ring. The fight's in Dallas Cowboys Stadium, right?
I think so.
So the size of the ring, I mean, they could fit whatever ring they wanted in there, but Canelo did want a smaller one. They ended up coming to terms, and Billy Joe Saunders showed up. So the fight is going to take place. But, a little bit of a hiccup to start.
Is there a line out on that?
There is definitely a line. I don't have it on me right now, but I'll get it for us here shortly.
Shit. And, well, let's just get into it. Speaking of lines, man, there's been a big movement here the past couple of years. As we all know, we're all glued to betting. Unfortunately, here in Texas, we kind of have to go through the back roads to get our bets in. You know, we all have our bookies out here, not going to say any names, not trying to indict myself, but we can't bet legally. And states here throughout the United States have been legalizing sports betting, mobile sports betting. They've been getting their setups. You know, DraftKings is pretty much set up in a lot of states, from New York, Virginia, Atlantic City's in Virginia, but anyway,
Michigan or Detroit, like
Michigan, a bunch of states are getting into this, and we're starting to see the fruits of the labor. We're starting to see, you know, all this tax income come in for the state, and for the state of New York, they're expected to bring in more tax revenue for sports betting, almost 100% more than what they're getting in the cannabis section in terms of the tax rates. So the only reason why I wanted to bring this up, guys, is just to kind of just harp on the fact that Texas doesn't have it yet. And I wanted to ask you guys, if we were to get it in Texas, would you go this route, or would you still continue to bet the way that you're betting right now?
I think if we had like a DraftKings sports book, you know, it'd probably be located in probably Dallas, Houston, or maybe Austin, I would think. Obviously not living directly in the city, it'd be hard to go and, you know, go directly to the window. But those books tend to offer a lot more props, and they just have a lot more options, exotics, parlays, that type of stuff. So with them being in the state, there would be a mobile app for them that you could use pretty much just like your bookie. So I think that would definitely be the route, just based on all the options. Player props, Super Bowl props, draft props. That was limited to us, you know, where we play. But they had down to the player that the team was going to draft that you could pick. You know what I mean? So
yeah, and I wanted to get in on those draft orders. If you could pick the draft order 1 through 5 correctly, because I thought I had a pretty good feel on Lance going at 3, but I couldn't find that option. So I like that. Richie, you're plugged in a little politically. Do you think Texas will ever legalize sports betting? Do you think it's something that we can look forward to in the next year or two?
I think so. If Dan Patrick is on the way out, I think we have a good chance. And he's under FBI investigation, I think. So, I
mean. Okay. Well,
so who's Dan Patrick? I don't know who that guy is.
I think he's the Attorney General of the state of Texas.
So he's got to be a like conservative. Because
he's a Republican, but I mean, I just know that he's opposed to that. I guess the legalization of sports.
Talking about the integrity of the sport and keeping the integrity.
I know if he wanted it, it would happen. So he'd be the guy.
Gotcha. And I mean, Texas still hasn't legalized marijuana. You know, they are on the back end.
They haven't even decriminalized it. So
right, they are behind on that boat. So honestly, I don't see it like. Maybe the next 5 years, but I wouldn't see Texas legalizing sports betting in the next year or two. I don't think so, personally.
A year or two, yeah. I mean, it all depends on how it goes with Patrick, in my opinion. But I think we'd get sports betting before we get marijuana legalized.
Okay.
I am on board with that. I do think we get sports betting in Texas before the legalization or decriminalization of marijuana at that. But speaking of lines, I'm sure Ben was in on this. I did not place a bet yesterday, or I don't know. I know it went down this week, but the semifinal for the Champions League went down. And so we have, for the first time in a little while, I want to say, an all Premier League Champions League final. We got Chelsea and Man City. What was y'all's big takeaways from those games? I did not watch those, so I can't put too much input on that.
Well, let's Richie, I'll ask you the question, and I'll let you kind of get us in it. But we'll start with Tuesday instead of just starting with yesterday's game. The Man City and PSG matchup, obviously the second leg of that, Man City was up 2-1. They won the game in France, wherever the first leg took place. Did you think that PSG was going to offer up some resistance? Because it didn't seem like much resistance. And I don't want to be disrespectful to them. I know Mbappe was playing with injuries and whatever it may be. But to be fair, Man City pretty much just did what everybody expected them to do. You know what I mean? A 2-0 win on Tuesday and a 2-1 win the first leg. What did you think about that matchup coming in? And did it play out the way you thought it was?
It did, only because, I mean, PSG has all the weapons you could want. I mean, and they technically almost have like an unlimited resource and money. They bought their team by taking like the highest bidders from all these elite squads. So the only thing they're missing is a real general on the back line. And by general, I mean someone that can force these dudes when they're off form or when they're up against the wall, that can literally force them to pick up their play, someone like Sergio Ramos or someone to that nature to light a fire under their butt. And I don't think they have it, dude. I mean, with how Barcelona came back from 6 goals on them, and they just don't have that spine that a champion has. And I think it's because league is, like, not strong. I know people call it a farmer's league. I don't think it is. But it isn't as strong as the others. And I guess I don't think they won this year. Correct me if I'm wrong, but they had a real go with OM and OL. So I know.
I think that they might have won. I'll look it up, but
it was close. I think Marseille
the coaching change also, because Pochettino is now the coach at PSG, ex Tottenham coach, and the old PSG coach. I don't have his name at the tip of my tongue right now, but he is now the coach for Chelsea. The coaching change. Did you think that they were going to be better off with Poch or not?
I'm a big fan, but I think it takes time to get into his system, for the players to get into his system and for him to get it really working. He's the kind of manager, in my opinion, that goes and builds a squad from his own, I guess, desires and gets the players that fulfill those specific roles. I don't know if – I guess PSG has an array of players, but I think it takes a minute for players to start getting to buy into his system and start performing that way. So I didn't think he was going to come in and turn them around, or you're going to see him destroy, or they're going to start destroying teams even more than they were before. But I think in 2 or 3 years, if he has that time, that he can build a champion.
But will Mbappe still be there in 2 to 3 years?
I think they're going to have to sell him, use that money to invest in youth and build from the ground up. And that's why they got Poch, in my opinion, because, I mean, look what he did at Spurs.
Can the same be said for Neymar? Do you think he's on the way out, or is he?
Yeah, I think he's on the way out.
Okay.
And our buddy Diego is a big PSG fan.
Biggest fan I know.
Yeah, big PSG fan. But, I mean, look, to give them – we'll give them some props. I don't just want to shit on them and say Man City walked all over them. But they did eliminate Bayern Munich the round prior, right? Mm-hmm. And that was another, you know, match or leg that they were underdogs in. They ended up – Bayern Munich, a lot of people thought, might have been the favorites, if not Man City, to win it all. I personally thought Bayern was a favorite to win Champions League.
Yeah, I didn't think they were going to be Bayern. I will say Bayern hasn't been in form like they are usually. But I really didn't think that they were going to. So that was, you know, all credit to PSG, right? They're a juggernaut in their own right. But I just don't think – I think they need a certain player that has a certain kind of trait and that, like, it – they need like a gritty Parisian, like a hometown kid to come up. And
they're too much finesse.
Yeah, I mean, they're a bunch of superstars, and like they're like the Galacticos light, you know. They don't have that that one player to push them over the edge, like mentally, you know, just to will them to victory. I don't think they have it. But when they do, I think they'll be, I mean, world beaters. I think they'll be able to compete definitely. But so, Man City's just a whole nother beast.
Yeah, so Pep finally, I mean, he's in the championship again for the Champions League, and he's looking to win his first championship against with Man City. He's looking to win his first Champions League championship with Man City. There we go. And it's going to be an all EPL final.
Yep.
Chelsea takes care of Real Madrid. I know Chelsea, since the coaching change, they have been one of the top teams, not only in the EPL, but just in all competition. And Real Madrid missing Sergio Ramos for the first leg of you know, the semifinals. He did come back in the finals, but you got to think, how healthy was he? We're talking about like a 35-year-old Sergio Ramos, I believe. He's around 35. So Real Madrid really wasn't in form. Chelsea was in form. The outcome you expected for this matchup?
No, not at all. I mean, it's hard for me to count out Madrid, you know. Real is always – they're like the opposite of PSG in terms of like
– the big stage.
The whole game. And then pull it out at the end. They're always known for that. They have that championship spine. I didn't think Chelsea was gonna run away with it or come out with the result that they did. But all credit to Chelsea, man. They're in crazy form. I think I can't pronounce his name, but I think Tuchel is killing it. I mean, I think he should start Pulisic and Reece James. But other than that, he's been a revelation for them.
And so they're using Pulisic as, you know, prior to us going live, you were saying like a super sub. What minute are they bringing him in? Are they bringing him in to start the second half? Because like we've seen teams like Man U, right? That's the way they use Cavani, if I'm not mistaken. And when Cavani comes in the second half, he usually makes a difference. Like you said, a super sub, a difference maker. So what minute have they been bringing Pulisic in?
I can't tell you off the top of my head, but I do know it's not like something that he's not starting like second halves or anything like that. I want to say anywhere from like the 55th to the 75th, probably before the 75th. They're bringing him in. It's an immediate impact. I think that they should start him. He's a spark plug. I don't know if it's part of the strategy that he wants to keep that ace in the hole. He doesn't know maybe if the starting, if Werner can come off the bench and have that impact. But I'm not a fan of Werner. And I think also to that effect, they should bench Azpilicueta for Reece James. I think Reece James is the real deal.
It's hard. I mean, the players, like you said, Pulisic, when he does go in, automatic spark plug. But with the success that they're having, I guess it's hard for the coach, you know, to change things up. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. That's one of my favorite sayings.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with that. It's working, obviously. Pulisic's killing it. Who knows? Maybe if they switch roles, Pulisic's hamstrings give out and things go awry. So that's another, I guess, angle to it. He could be preserving the hamstrings of Pulisic because, you know, that guy has a lot of soft muscle issues. So that's also another angle we could see that. That could be the reason why as well.
So let's hear your picks. Who do you guys got?
In the final, Chelsea and Man City. I know Man City is like a 3-1 favorite to win it. So there is really good odds on Chelsea. For me, man, I'm going to make it quick and simple. I think that Chelsea, all they need is one goal. And with one goal, they can win. Their defense is just that elite right now. They're locking it down on their side. Even this past game against Real Madrid had about 65% possession and lost 2-0. 2-0. And honestly, they could have had 4 or 5 goals because Chelsea missed some pretty easy shots. So I'm going to be on the underdog. Personally, I'm going to be on Chelsea. I think it's going to be a low-scoring game because of the style that they play, and I'm hoping 1-0, maybe 2-0 Chelsea win.
Who do you got, Rich?
I got 2-1 City.
Really?
I just – KDB, Kevin De Bruyne, and – I just can't count that guy out. That guy, I mean, they could be down one zip and he could pull up from like 45 yards out with a thunder strike, you know. Yeah. They have those kind of players. Pep is in his first final with City finally. Sergio Aguero is on his way out, and he's a big game player. I could see him coming up and giving it his all and having a brace, you know. So I got City 2-1.
I'm not a soccer expert by any means, but that won't stop me from betting on the game. I am going to go with the underdog. I like Chelsea. I like the defense that they're playing right now. And I'm a United fan. I hate both of these teams, but I think I hate Man City a little bit more, and I can't stand to see them win the big one. I'd want to have that over my brother still and be like, you guys still can't win the big one. Because my brother's a big City fan, so that's the last thing I want to see is my brother rejoicing with a Champions League victory. So
honestly, the great thing is it's only one game. So, you know, exactly. It's kind of like the Super Bowl where it's not a series like the NBA or even two legs like the previous, rounds. This is one game. So if Chelsea gets that one goal and they park the damn bus and don't allow anything, that's all it takes. So I'm excited for it. Do we know the date? Does anybody have the date on that? I know it's usually on a Saturday. They do usually have it on a weekend.
Let me pull this up real quick. It's going to be on 29th of May. So it's going to be Memorial Day weekend. So Memorial Day weekend is going to be fun.
Pretty soon. Yeah, definitely. That is dope that they're getting done all quickly.
Mm-hmm. So moving on, kind of changing sports here. This one won't be too we won't spend too much time on this, but everybody likes to comment on the analysts that call the play-by-plays and the NBA especially. Especially if you're watching the regionally or even through the big broadcast, but Chris Webber, he's been on TNT's lead team for the past couple of years. It seems like he's been on there for at least 5 years. He's on his way out from TNT. And I know he's always been the guy that's probably out of all the commentators that do play-by-play caught the most flack. I know we like to talk about guys like Bill Walton as being fun. But we also talk about guys like Chris Webber as being like Captain Obvious and not really bringing too much to the broadcast. Are you guys going to miss Chris Webber? Or are you glad that he's out?
I'll let Rich go first.
Yeah, I don't have a lot of love for Chris Webber, so I'll say I'm glad he's out. So that's where I stand.
I was a fan of his playing days, but to be honest, I don't even listen to the TV with volume on. Usually music playing in the background. So I won't miss Chris Webber.
Chris Webber, though, he might retire from being a sports analyst and drop a couple of hip-hop tracks. I don't know if you guys know, but he was like a producer in the 90s. He has a couple of producing credits on some pretty decent albums.
What type of artist?
Like hip-hop and R&B.
Can you give me an artist?
Yeah, hold on.
Come on,
Chris Webber, Babyface.
Chris Webber produced songs.
Can't come with the random facts rolling and not give us.
He does have some music credits. Okay, he was a producer on Nas's album, Hip Hop Is Dead. I know that wasn't one of his best ones, but he was on Hip Hop Is Dead by Nas, and he produced a song for Naughty by Nature. Back in 95. So Chris Webber, man, we'll look out for him as a producer.
The next Scott Storch.
Hey, who knows? He might have a lot more time on his hands now that he's not going to be calling NBA games anymore. But moving on, though.
Dodging Jalen Rose's request to meet up. That's what he's been doing, producing tracks.
He still does need to do that reunion. I know he's been like the guy that's held out. And I mean, he's also the guy that gets made fun of the most.
Especially now with Juwan Howard there, bro. Like, now would be the time.
And props to Juwan Howard for what he did. This was his first year, right, I want to say?
Yeah,
his first year. Yeah, props to him. But moving on, and this will lead us into our NFL. But Albert Pujols, he's released from the Angels. They decided to make the move today. Wasn't having, I guess, too good of a start to a year. Everybody knew he was kind of on the way out. This was the last year of his 10-year contract that he signed back in 2011 with the Angels. For the most part, played out nine of those 10 years. 10 years, $240 million was a number back then. He has 21 seasons in the league, perennial All-Star, three-time MVP, two Golden Gloves, six Silver Sluggers, All-Star 10 times. Safe to say he's going to be a first ballot Hall of Famer. He stands at fifth all-time in home runs and third all-time in RBIs. Is Albert Pujols, is he one of your top 10 players right now? Where do you think he stands, like, in the all-time rankings? Is he up there with the greats of the greats?
He's a top 10 hitter. I don't know about overall player. But I mean, no doubt Hall of Famer, first ballot. And honestly, he got cut. I think that he is going to go sign with somebody and possibly, you know, DH for a team. So that's where I stand. Last year he played 39 games, only 25 RBIs. I mean, 25 RBIs in 39 games, that's an RBI in over 50% of your games. That's not bad. Obviously, he was on that huge deal, so, you know, he won't be getting that type of money anymore, but I don't think his career is done.
I think he's probably, safe to say, our generation's best hitter, right? I mean, I remember for years and years, there's people saying there's nobody that makes an adjustment better in the batting box better than Albert Pujols. It's almost I remember Vladimir Guerrero being a guy that like could hit any ball like thrown in the dirt. He would take one for a home run. Right. Albert Pujols, though, straight machine. I mean, that was his nickname. He was the machine for the great part of his career before he became Fat Albert here towards the end. But for me, Albert Pujols is as good as it gets, man. I want to see him maybe get the 700 home runs. I think he's at 667 right now. But for the most part, I grew up hating Albert Pujols because I was an Astros fan.
He did win a World Series with the Cardinals, right?
Yeah, he won a World Series.
On the David Freese team?
Yeah.
I hate Pujols so much, dude.
Shit, I still remember. I have nightmares. Did you say the David Lidge or Brad Lidge?
No, I said him and Jim Edmonds. Bro.
Yeah, him and Jim Edmonds.
Jim Edmonds.
Oh, yeah. I have nightmares of the stare that Albert Pujols gave Brad Lidge on that night that he hit that walk-off home run.
Ruined him mentally. Broke him.
Mm-hmm. And Brad Lidge was never the same after that. He did win a World Series with the Phillies.
Right? Phillies.
Yeah. But with this,
I was gonna say, Roland, some people used to call Ryan Howard the best hitter of our generation, bro. All right, when he was in those Subway sandwiches,
That lasted for like a year or two, and then
Ryan Howard fell off quick.
He fell off hard, yeah, he did fall off hard. But you know, one guy, potentially ending his career for sure, ending a historic run with a team in terms of, you know. You don't see too many guys finish out those big contracts.
So here's the thing. Was it a historic run? I mean, they made the playoffs 1 year that he was there. Was it a
historic run from the perspective of he finished out the contract. He finished out the 10 years, 240. You don't see that happen. I mean, I don't think I've seen anybody really get to the end of that.
And he had over 100 RBIs in six of those seasons. You know, obviously the COVID season last year and only playing 39 games. But he was, aside from Trout, he was their second best player for the majority of those 10 years of his contract.
They probably caught him on the back end of his prime. And, you know, the way that they built that team, they were never really able to invest in anything else, really. It was just Trout, Pujols, and whoever they can put together in the bullpen and their pitchers. So that's why Trout, as much as people love him, you talk about him winning MVP, but being at home by the time the playoffs start, because he's not there. Exactly. So Albert Pujols, a great run. Hopefully he finds a team to play with to maybe finish this year off before he goes off into the sunset. But for sure, first ballot Hall of Famer. But this brings me to another first ballot Hall of Famer, and this is going to kick us off with NFL. Aaron Rodgers. Brett Favre seems to think that he's done in Green Bay. These past couple weeks started with the draft. Aaron Rodgers let out a big bomb saying that he doesn't want to go back to Green Bay unless the GM
is fired.
Is currently there is fired. Aaron Rodgers has been there for, I want to say, at least 12 years. They've never drafted a first-round wide receiver. I think they've gone defense the majority of the years in the first round that Aaron Rodgers has been there, and that's where a lot of his ire is drawn from. But before I toss it, I'm going to toss it over to you guys asking this. Does Aaron Rodgers suit up as a Packer this year, week one, and see on the field, or do you really think he's on the out? Richie, you start. What do you think?
Oh man, this is tough. I think he'll retire, because I don't think the Packers are going to get it. I don't think anyone's going to offer the Packers something they think is worth it. And I think that him and that GM just have it on the outs, and I think he's done.
He called him Jerry Krause.
Yeah, I think he's done. I think he's. I think he. I don't think he's going to be a Packer, and I don't think the Packers are going to get a package good enough to trade him. And I think he'll retire. And they're going to eat it, and they're going to start doing the.
Did you think that Niners package was good enough? I mean, we heard Garoppolo. We heard the number 3 overall pick. Was it just not enough time for the Packers?
That's as good as it gets.
I'm in agreement with you, Roland. That's as good as it gets.
Yeah, I just think it's because they were the Niners. They weren't about it.
They didn't want to trade him. Maybe in just keep him in the NFC. And also, I think if that news would have broke a week before the draft, bro, I really think that he might have been gone. Because to me, Aaron Rodgers doesn't need football. He just comes off as a guy that just doesn't need football. We already heard him say that he wanted to host Jeopardy and play at the same time. I agree with Richie. I see him retiring. If that GM doesn't leave, he's a prick. We've heard he's a prick his whole career. And I could see him, you know, showing us his pride, sticking to his guns, retiring because he doesn't need football. And Green Bay hasn't done anything to help him. Again, this year in the draft, they went DB first round. They didn't get him a receiver. They didn't get him O-line, any type of help. And listen, if you're – he's sitting there with his replacement. His replacement got drafted last year. So he's been sitting there with him. And then you get an offer as good as the Niners gave you. They're going to give you Garoppolo, who maybe you can start if you still don't think that Love is ready. And they're going to give you the number 3 overall pick. What was Green Bay going to do with the number 3 overall pick? That's what I think was a deal breaker. Like, what were they going to do? Draft Chase at number 3 overall?
Probably not.
Who? Like, there was nobody there for them to take at 3 overall that they needed to take that deal, but that was as good as it's going
to
get.
And maybe they're not ready to throw out Jordan Love. Because I've been hearing, too, from almost anybody who talks about that situation, that there's people who don't think that Jordan Love is that guy. Like, they don't think he belongs on the field.
How many years did Rodgers sit under Favre before they threw him out there?
I want to say he got 2. I know for sure he had 1 with the clipboard.
I said 2 or 3.
I believe it was 2 or 3. It was for sure 2, possibly 3. But, and I mean, that's Aaron Rodgers. He was higher touted than Jordan Love was coming
for
out
sure,
of the draft.
For sure. And Aaron Rodgers just won MVP. So there's no way that
can you trade the MVP?
Nah, you can't do that. And that would have been crazy for them to do. So I give the Packers props for standing by their guns and not trading Aaron Rodgers and realizing, hey, we have the upper hand with the contract situation. You really can't do much. You can cry, do whatever you want, but we're not going to move you. But I'm going to toss it back to you guys again. Do you think Aaron Rodgers has a point? Because Terry Bradshaw was out here pretty much calling Aaron Rodgers the P word. He was out here calling him this. I'm not going to say it on air, but he was calling out Aaron Rodgers for being weak and soft. Are you on the side of the franchise or the player here? I'm going to say it real quick before you guys get into it. I'm always on the player side, and I see what they've done to not help him. So I'm going to toss it back to you guys.
Yeah, I gotta say I'm with Rodgers on this one. While he did sign a contract, he's on the, I guess, the tail end of an elite career. He wants to go out a winner or just have a chance to make it to the big dance. He sees the Packers aren't helping him like the Bucks are helping Brady in his last stand. So, you know, I'm sure Rodgers thinks he's better than Brady. So it has to leave a nasty taste in his mouth. They see that he's not getting that help. Or maybe that also rubs him the wrong way, thinking that the GM doesn't think that he has that factor that can take him over the edge. So I'm with Rodgers, man. They gave him no help. And yeah.
You got to be with Rodgers because they started the – yeah, he's in the contract, but they started the fuckery when they drafted Jordan Love last year. That's when shit started going downhill. And wasn't it that GM's first year, or the GM had already been there?
Well, I know it was LaFleur's first year.
Right. And usually head coaches and GMs come in on the same year sometimes when they clean house. I'm not sure if that's how it happened there. But the fuckery started when they drafted Love. And obviously – you ask me, Aaron Rodgers leaked that shit as soon as he heard the Niners wanted him. Yo, I'm out of here. Now, question to you. I know Richie said he'll retire. I said he would retire. If the Packers do trade him, I know that they already put up odds, and the Broncos have the best odds of landing him, followed by the Raiders. Obviously, both AFC teams, which would make sense for the Packers to send him that way. Do you all see him possibly? And this shit would piss me off because John Elway is a piece of shit GM, bro. That guy just has guys go and save his ass, bro. Dude. He can't find a quarterback. Oh, my God.
That's why he recused himself from picking picking players in the draft. He's not the GM anymore. He's like the president of operations.
Imagine Aaron Rodgers saving his ass.
I could see it. But what do the Broncos offer them for Aaron Rodgers? Like, what do they have? They had the 7th pick in the draft, and if they weren't going to take the 3rd pick from San Francisco.
Exactly. That's why I said it was as good as it gets with San Francisco and that offer. Maybe the Raiders can put together a package. I mean, they can maybe toss over Derek Carr and give the Packers maybe a bridge quarterback until they're ready to give Jordan Love and some picks. But I think Aaron Rodgers, he's going to find a way to play, man. I mean, he's too good not to play. He's one of the GOATs. And when one of the GOATs says something, they usually find a way to get it done. But
Roland, one of the GOATs with one Super Bowl ring? It's hard to fucking call him a GOAT.
And that was going to be, one of my next questions before we left the subject is, you know, I tweeted something out today about the Packers really being a failure of a franchise, if you think about it, because you have Brett Favre, you get one title out of him, and then you conveniently transfer it over to Aaron Rodgers, and you only have one title to show for him. That's like 30 years of history right there, and you got two titles, maybe arguably top 10 quarterbacks. Is that a failure to you guys, or do you think they have made
– How long was McCarthy the coach there?
McCarthy was a coach for at least, I want to say, 7 years. He was there for a while.
Even to nine?
Because he had both Favre and Rodgers, no? McCarthy coached Favre, or he didn't coach Favre at all?
I don't think he coached him as the head coach. I want to say he was on the staff, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, so
I think Reno was on that staff too.
It's got to be a failure by it. Definitely got to be a failure by the Packers. And you can say, you know, Rodgers, a lot of people were giving him shit last year for not diving on that fumble when they were playing the Niners in that game. So he has been questioned sometimes for – and, like, he's a quarterback, obviously. Like, a lot of – you don't expect a lot of quarterbacks to be diving into piles, but you do see the ones that will. And that's the difference between Brady and Rodgers. Brady does get dirty. We've seen Brady lead block on end of rounds. Like, there are certain guys who do everything to get it done. And then, you know, Aaron Rodgers plays quarterback, and I feel like it stops there. I don't even feel like he's that great of a leader in the locker room. So I'm not going to put it all on the Packers, but they didn't help him as far as free agency and drafts. They didn't help him, no. But I wouldn't call him a GOAT. I wouldn't.
Could have been. So he's not on your top five quarterback list?
No.
Okay.
For the league, or like, are you saying of all time?
He's probably saying all time.
Yeah.
Who's on your list?
All time? I mean, you're putting me on the spot, but I mean, in the league, last year when we did QBs, I believe I had him 4 currently. If I had him currently 4 in the league, I'm pretty sure with 50 years of history, I can find 2 guys better than him.
Yeah, and we'll visit that later on in the summer as we get into our lists, as we like to do. But, you know, flipping from one spectrum to the other, and spectrum meaning one guy ending his career or maybe going off into the sunset, and Aaron Rodgers to, you know, this incoming rookie class. We did go live for the draft last week, and it was pretty exciting, depending what team you were for. But nonetheless, every time there's a draft, you're going to get some guys that are going to step right in, and they're going to tear shit up, whether it's a quarterback. We see wide receivers and running backs come right in and tear stuff up right off the bat. We saw Kyle Pitts get drafted high to the Falcons. We saw Ja'Marr Chase go to the Bengals. Trevor Lawrence, obviously a quarterback, got drafted number 1 to the Jaguars. So out of all the rookies that got drafted, which ones or which two do you guys see, if you have more than one, seen making an instant impact on their team? And day one, you can slot them in as a starter, and they're going to be making an impact for their franchise.
I'll let Ben take this
one. Yeah, you got me when you said day one. Because
day one, like Kyle Pitts, Ja'Marr Chase.
It's, yeah, because, but at day one, you kind of like, it's kind of like top 10-ish. Like, I honestly think that Fields is going to help his team the most out of all the rookies this coming year, but I don't think that he's going to be starting day one. Hoping that the Bears do like the Tua and Fitzpatrick thing with Fields and Andy Dalton. Hopefully the plan is after the bye week, we're throwing you in. We're throwing you in no matter what the record is. We saw the Dolphins that were in the playoffs going into the bye week. They came back with Tua, and they didn't end up making the playoffs. But that was the Dolphins' plan the whole time. Personally, I think that Fields is going to get the Bears into the playoffs this coming year. And especially if Aaron Rodgers is retired.
And that's fair. That kind of answers my question. I know I said day one, but I'm just looking for the biggest impact, their rookie season.
I got Najee Harris with the Steelers, man. I think he's the guy that they need. Granted,
some people are going to be happy to hear that, Rich.
Granted, their O-line is
trash,
I don't know if they can scheme themselves out of, you know, poor talent on the line. Especially, I mean, losing Pouncey is massive. Villanueva, he wasn't, from what I've been reading, the Steelers are happy to see the backside of him. But and from what I've also read, that he wasn't the greatest. I think he was a good run blocker, but his pass blocking was suspect. I just don't know. I don't know if I don't even know if they addressed offensive line.
They didn't.
I don't think they did it in free agency either very much. So, and Big Ben's immobile. It's going to be.
They have the toughest schedule in the league so far. That's what they're saying.
Yeah. And also, though, don't sleep on Zach Wilson. He's starting from day one.
Okay. And so I like that.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan, but I think he – I mean, who else is going to do it in New York?
Mm-hmm.
But what are the expectations? Like, is he going to be the big – like, if they have a 4 or 5-win season, you know?
I think they are going to have, a 4 or 5-win season. He just needs to show that he makes the right reads, and his ratio for, interceptions and touchdown isn't, crazy.
If he just has to wow us a couple times throughout the 17 games.
As long as you can see that it's the team that's terrible and he's not just making blatantly terrible calls, then there's some hope. But if he's, pissing his pants and pulling a Darnold seeing ghosts and all that kind of stuff, it's going to be a rough one.
How do you think it's going to go? I know our podcast was kind of split on him.
Honestly, I think he'll be middle of the road as a rookie. I think I could see him throwing.
He has.
I bet you he'll throw 10 picks.
But could you see him having a Justin Herbert? Because we didn't see the Chargers win a lot of games, but Herbert did show flashes at times.
I could see Zach Wilson having a Justin Herbert type flash. He can show it. I mean, that's why they drafted him. He popped off the tape.
He has that X factor, the ability to throw a 75-yard bomb on a broken play. So.
We're not going to compare him to Patrick Mahomes.
No, we're not going to do that.
Patrick Mahomes, man.
Comparison seems to be what got him drafted.
Poor man's Pat Mahomes.
For me, I'm probably take the easy way out, but I like Ja'Marr Chase. I like him stepping in with a familiar face in Joe Burrow, and that offense, Zach Taylor likes to air it out. The only asterisk on that is, Joe Burrow does have to be healthy, and it has to be Joe Burrow throwing him the ball. But I do like Ja'Marr Chase stepping right into that offense. He's already got a good receiving core, so not all the attention is going to be on him. And I like him, man. He has a lot of – I saw the pro comparison for him was A.J. Brown. I see a lot of A.J. Brown, a lot of Odell Beckham in him. He's a guy that can take the top off the offense, and he makes all those 50-50 catches. So look for Ja'Marr Chase to be on a few highlight reels this year. But I like him. And then I'm interested, man. I'm very, very intrigued to see how Kyle Pitts fits in with the Falcons. You got Pitts and Jones.
They're going to be losing a lot of games and airing it out a lot in the second half of games. So, I mean, that's a guy who you could draft, I believe, in fantasy football and can make an immediate impact. Like, he can be top 10 tight end in fantasy football, I think, with that offense. Because Julio Jones is going to miss games like he does every year.
Mm-hmm.
That's just going to happen. And they're probably going to be lining that dude up out wide as well. We've seen the versatility with him at Florida. So Kyle Pitts, I do have high expectations for him fantasy football-wise for sure.
All right. I like that. And just moving on to the part of the NFL section that I'm sure we've all been waiting for. It's been a week since the draft has passed, but we're here to talk about, you know, our teams. Richie and I here, and Justin also. I know he's not here with us today, but we're all Cowboys fans here. Ben announced to the world.
To the masses,
to the masses last week that he's going to be jumping through some tables this season as part of Bills Mafia. So we're going to go over the Bills and the Cowboys draft. We're going to start off with the Cowboys because they did draft first out of the two. They did come into the draft with the number 10 pick, but they did trade. It was kind of a surprise to a lot of us. They traded
back with the Eagles.
They traded back with the Eagles, NFC East rival, but it was kind of to spurn the Giants, who were picking 11. And so the Eagles ended up drafting DeVonta Smith with the 10th spot after the Cowboys missed out on J.C. Horn and Patrick Surtain. What could have been, those were the two top targets for the Cowboys. But we end up with Micah Parsons and Kelvin Joseph with our first two picks. I'm going to toss this off to Rich. Rich, do you like those two picks? Granted, the circumstances that the Cowboys found themselves in with their top two targets off the board. Do you like what the Cowboys did?
I think that I do like what they did. I do. Getting an extra third from moving down two spots, knowing that one of, and I guess people comment on, you know, the whole trading with Philly thing, but one of Philly and New York, we're going to get Smith.
Yeah. Now, one of them we're walking away with.
We had the opportunity to choose which one, and we had the opportunity to get, you know, rewarded for, you know, choosing one of them. So I think they did the right thing there. I kind of would have liked the offensive lineman, Slater, the one that went to the Chargers. I think even though our O-line is pretty dang good, Tyron Smith's injuries, you know, are catching up with him.
Hasn't played a full season in like 4 years.
Just paid Dak a big deal, you know. Slater, I think, would have been solid. He's versatile. He can fit in any position, I think, except for center. So I think that would have been a hell of a pick, but I think Parsons is gonna be a solid addition. I think he'll end up taking Van Der Esch position because we declined his fifth year.
Yep.
So, I do like what they did, and with Kelvin Joseph, from what I've been reading, he's a first round talent, man coverage kind of guy. He just has the attitude problem. So a lot of those attitude problems will work in your favor when you're a cornerback. Quarterbacks with the mean streaks, especially in the Dan Quinn kind of offense, would be, I guess, ideal. So I can see why they did that. So I'm happy with the pick.
Death taxes and the Cowboys not caring about character. Can always count on those three things right there.
Exactly.
Cowboys never run a background check in their life, baby.
Hey, just to piggyback on what Richie said, so Smith was going to end up in the division, like you said. It was just, was it going to be to the Giants or was it going to be to the Eagles?
Yeah.
Here is my problem. Fine, but could you not have gotten more than a third-round pick? We saw what the Bears did to trade up two spots after the Cowboys or one spot right after the Cowboys. The Bears gave up next year's first-rounder for the pick after the Cowboys. So my question to you is, like, it's got to pain you to do business with the Eagles as it is, and it's just got to be straight out of left field, but you got to make them cough up a little more, I would think.
I think if one of the quarterbacks was there, one of the other quarterbacks besides Mac Jones was there, I think we would have gotten a lot. But I think I think we would have also traded with somebody else. I don't think Philly would have gotten that spot, and New York probably would have picked up Smith. But because Fields got taken by Chicago, Mac Jones, everyone knew the Pats liked him, and no one else did really before.
But what I was saying was they picked him at 11. The Giants got next year's first round pick from the Cowboys to move for the Bears to move up to 11. Like the Cowboys traded out of 10 for the Eagles 13, and then the Bears moved into 11. The Giants, I know their Gettleman, I believe, is their GM. He traded back for the first time in his career as a GM. So at pick 11, the Bears gave up their first rounder this year and their first rounder next year for the 11th pick, after the Cowboys obviously had already dealt their 10th pick for the Eagles.
And I think Richie brought up a good point. It was for the quarterback, right? So you see how much more you can yield for that. So I think the Cowboys did a good thing in getting that third. Maybe they could have gotten a little bit more. But at the end of the day, the Eagles probably wouldn't have given up much more because they would have been like, well, if we end up not getting our guy in Devontae Smith, well, we can pivot off of that. Like, it's not the end of the world, I guess. You know, it's a receiver. It's a skill player. Not as valuable as a quarterback. I do like the Kelvin Joseph pick. I do think we needed some speed on that side of the ball. I don't think he's a day one starter, though, which is what, as a Cowboys fan, I wanted. I wanted a day one cornerback that you could plug in on the other side of Trayvon Diggs and call it a day. I don't think we got that with Kelvin Joseph. I think he's going to find himself probably behind Jordan Lewis, too. I think he's going to be behind Trayvon Diggs. He's going to be behind Jordan Lewis to start the year. And I'm blanking out on our other corner's name. But I find him maybe going to be third or fourth on the depth chart. I do like the Jabril Cox pickup from LSU, another linebacker to go ahead with Micah Parsons, who Micah Parsons coming into the draft or coming into the year was one of the, if not the top rated defensive player, one of the top rated guys coming into the year. He did opt out, so he didn't play this past year, so maybe he dropped a little bit. But Micah Parsons, a stud of a prospect. Richie mentioned we did not renew or we didn't pick up the fifth year on Vander Esch. And Jalen Smith, we still don't know what we really have too much with him. He's good in pursuit, but he over pursues a lot. So we'll see what happens with that linebacking core. But I think the Cowboys, like I said, it was more of a what could have been draft for me, because like I said, we came in with these expectations. A Surtain or Horn ended up not working out. But they did do a good job of checking the box when it comes to picking up needs, right? We saw them address cornerback. We saw them address linebacker, defensive line. They went defense for the vast majority of this draft. And shit, the defense was Swiss cheese last year. Swiss cheese, yeah. Man. It was basura. So we definitely needed to go all defense. It was boring. If you're into drafting skill position players and you got spoiled with the Cowboys going after CeeDee Lamb when we really didn't need to, but what were you going
to
say?
I wanted to ask y'all about that. Like, I mean, obviously you got CeeDee last year. You got the Heisman Trophy winner sitting there when you're picking 10 at this year. Would you all rather have preferred Smith or Lamb?
That's a good question. Go, Rich. You answer. You're our guest.
I like CeeDee, man. I like him a lot. I like Lamb a lot. I think, I mean, he's bigger. And that's a lot of questions people are saying they don't think because of Smith's size that he can take the physicality. But, I mean, he can definitely fill that DeSean Jackson-type mold, even though he can do more things than DeSean, I'd say.
Yeah.
I'm pretty happy with the Cowboys draft, though. I guess the reason I was upset is because we had an abundance of third and fourth round picks, and we didn't act aggressively enough to move up in the second. I wanted us to move up low in the second with those extra third and fourths to pick some of the guys I wanted. So that's the only thing I really didn't like. I think there was a lot of prospects on the board, namely the safety from TCU that got picked, a pick right before us. So that's the reason I was kind of upset with the draft. They weren't aggressive.
Was that Newsom, Richie, or am I thinking of somebody else?
No, Newsom was that corner from Northwestern.
Newsom was Northwestern.
Okay, my bad. It's purple.
Trevor, I can't pronounce the last name, Morig. I think the safety from TCU.
He went like three picks right after Newsom, though, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah, and I want to say he was literally right before us. They moved up. I think the Raiders moved up.
The what could have been. We missed out on some guys, one or two picks before. Yeah. So draft grade, Rich, before we move on to the Bills, what do you got for the Cowboys? I know it's kind of crazy giving them draft grades right now in May when the we really won't find out the draft grade until they play, but based on the needs and who they pick.
Based on needs,
I give them a C minus.
Really, that's a tough grade, Rich.
I was gonna give them a B.
The only reason I give them such a low grade is because while we did patch up the holes with bodies, essentially,
bodies,
we have a lot of guys that are low floor, high ceiling, outside of, I guess, the top two picks. So they could hit, you know, like that corner from Oregon State could be, you know, what we need for Dan Quinn's offense at a corner.
Defense. Or,
you know, just pan out and, I guess, be what all the other experts rated him to be, and that's a seventh round talent. So He has a, I guess, the floor of a seventh rounder and a ceiling of we don't know yet. So that's the only reason. There's a lot of low floor guys.
Okay. All right. I like that. You're honest. And like Ben said, we need some of that here on the podcast.
It's about time we get some honesty when it comes to the Cowboys.
I really wanted a safety, man.
I give him a B. I thought they checked off the needs, and that's kind of all you could do. And they did, in my opinion. I know Rich would have liked a little bit more aggressiveness using some of those picks that we had to move up, which I think would have probably been the best move to make. But for what we were dealt, I thought the Cowboys did okay. I'm not going to sit here and say that they failed. I know C's not failing, but I'm a little bit of an easier grader. I'll give them a B on this one. I'm an easy grader.
All of these years being a Cowboy fan has me jaded, man. So yeah. I'm just like, you know what? C-. How about that? Give me a ring. Give me a ring. If you would have given me a ring, I probably would have been like, you know, B-. You know what? I haven't seen a ring since I was four.
So. We definitely don't want to be drafting in the top 10 this time next year, right? Let's just put it that way. As long as we're not in the top 10, we'll call this a success. And moving into a team that was not in the top 10, and we have a new fan here, it's the Buffalo Bills.
A bandwagoner.
Hey, but hey, at least you're owning up to it. This is your first year as a Bills fan, so you can be called a bandwagoner. But after that, you know, I'll give you your props.
If I'm going to fucking go hard for them.
Yeah. Exactly.
I go hard when I like a team.
Is it really bandwagon if he's becoming a fan of a perennial?
No.
That's the thing. That's the other thing that I was saying. Like, they won a playoff game for the first time in like a decade this past year. So, and I understand why I could be bandwagoning. They were in the AFC Championship game. You know, that's fine. I get it. But it is what it is. Like, they're not a winning franchise.
No, that's not what they're known for. Yeah, they lost four Super Bowls in a row. So
they're known for being good, but not good enough.
Yeah. So Ben, I'm gonna dress it up here. I'm gonna go through
like
the top two or three picks, and you just let me know if you have any insight or if you like what they did. So with their first pick, they drafted 30th. So like we said, they were in the AFC Championship game this past year. They drafted this guy, Gregory Rousseau, out of Miami. He's an edge rusher. He's going to come in defensive end. He's going to be right next to Ed Oliver. We know Buffalo, they love their defense. They love their defensive line at that. And then they followed that up, drafting defensive line again, also another defensive end. Carlos Basham out of Wake Forest. Yeah. Do you like what they did in the first two rounds? They went defense.
Like you all, where both of the DBs got taken before the Cowboys pick and you were expecting a DB to be drafted, I was expecting us to get a running back, preferably Travis Etienne. I know even Vegas had set the over-under for the running backs in the first round. I don't know if it was 1.5 or 2, but they did expect one running back to get drafted in the first round. Obviously, the Jaguars fucking teamed up ATN with Trevor Lawrence, which wasn't a need for them because they had an undrafted rookie running back last year in Robinson that killed it. They signed Carlos Hyde out of free agency. And then Urban Meyer says, we drafted Travis ATN to be a third down running back for the Jacksonville Jaguars. Didn't make much sense. Came off the board right after Najee Harris. Pissed me off because I'm not a big fan of the Buffalo Bills backfield.
Zach Moss,
and wasn't it Singletary, right?
Yeah.
Devin Singletary, yeah, Zach Moss.
Yeah, I like Zach Moss more than I like Singletary, but man, Travis Etienne back there with Allen, that would have been sick. So that's obviously what I wanted. But the theme that I saw from them, like you saw defensive end, first and second round, drafting needs. We also took two offensive tackles in the draft. Obviously, another need, one from Texas Tech in the seventh round and another one from Northern Iowa in the third round, and then safety and DB. So not really any sexy picks, you know, nothing, nobody you go out there and buy the jersey of just yet. But gritty dudes, defense. I mean, I'm not mad at drafting defense when you got Josh Allen calling the signals on the other side. I just think running back is the only hole that offense has. And tight end, but I wasn't very excited about many of the tight ends in this draft.
No, outside of Pitts, you really didn't hear about too many guys. Yeah. So don't blame you for not taking defensive end there.
The defensive end out of Miami, though, in the first round, man, like he would have been a way higher pick, but he did opt out of the season.
Yeah,
this past year. But in 2019, I mean, we're 15 and a half sacks at Miami at defensive end. So definitely a way different player than the second round pick, the defensive end from Wake Forest. The guy from Wake Forest is gritty as hell. He's mean. He's a dog. And I'm not even going to try and say his last name. Dude from Miami, Rousseau. Yeah, he's more polished, but like he's got more moves. He's not as mean. So excited for the defense to be good. Obviously a defense that was already pretty good, took a step back last year. But the secondary is pretty good, and they just needed pass rushers. So
two questions for you. Draft grade for the Bills.
B.
Okay, and then do they keep the AFC East? Do you like them to be the kings of the AFC East?
We're going to see a rematch. I don't want to spoil anything, but I think that we're going to see a rematch again of Bills and Chiefs.
Okay. I like that. So I'm excited, actually, to have, you know, the Bills become a part of the podcast as we go forward and start talking about the NFL as we get closer to the start of the season, start of the off season and whatnot, you know, because before it's just the Cowboys and Texans. That kind of gets a little overplayed. So I like the fact that Ben went out on a leap and chose the Bills as a new team. Like I said, I'll start giving him his props in the middle of the season and as he sticks through some lows with that team. But
I have to live up to my word, though, and I do have to go through.
Yeah, you do have to go through a table.
At least one, if not multiple tables.
Honestly, like, you should do that, like, week one, just to be like, hey, let's throw that out there. I'm a new fan.
Maybe we'll release the video week one. Yeah. But it'll definitely happen prior to week one.
Yeah, got to do that. And going on more general, biggest draft winners and losers for you guys. I'm going to start this one off because I have to run to the restroom real quick and end it real quick. I'm gonna go ahead and go with the Bears. I like what they did.
Winners
as a winner, yes. Okay. I like the Bears as a winner because they went out and they got their guy, Justin Fields. You don't know how long that regimen has in terms of Ryan Pace as a GM and Nagy as the head coach, but there's no more excuses now.
So you went out, straw, right?
Yeah, you went out and you got your guy in Justin Fields. This is the guy that you handpicked to run your offense. Now let's go out and see what you got to do. And like Ben said, if there's no Aaron Rodgers in the NFC North, what's to stop the Bears from going and making a move? They already have a strong defense. You just need a guy to not lose the game for you at the quarterback position.
Just make the right plays. Don't turn it over. That's it.
And that's Justin Fields. I like him. So I'll be right back. You guys take it away.
Go for it, Ben.
Rich, as far as my big winner, I'm pretty much going to take the easy way out, but And it sucks that it happened to this team, but you got to think Mac Jones is a New England Patriots type quarterback, and the fact that they didn't even have to trade up, they didn't have to give up any type of draft picks or anything to get the biggest need on that team, which is quarterback. We saw them give Cam that 1 year deal again, little band-aid quarterback, but I got to say the biggest winners are the Patriots just based on the fact that they had Mac Jones, who was talked about all draft week as he's going number three. And then he ends up falling right into the Patriots lap at 14 or 15, whenever it was that they picked. So for me, that's my biggest winner.
I want to say my biggest winner, and I think this is going to come as a shock to a lot of folks, are the Lions. The Lions picking up Sewell, could be their foundation, you know, for the Lions going forward. I don't think Goff is total crap, you know. I think Sewell, I think there's potential there. I think if they can build on that, they picked a lot of defenders. I know that they got a couple of DTs, both of them I wanted for Dallas. McNeil out of North Carolina State and Levi out of Washington. Not to mention they got the corner that we wanted, UVA 2 from Syracuse. So I think the Lions had a hell of a draft, and I think they're my winner.
Okay. Who did you pick, Ben? I didn't hear that.
I picked the Pats just because they had Mac Jones fall right in their lap, didn't have to give up any draft capital or anything to get, obviously, the biggest hole on their team. But another one, just because of how bad they fucked it up last year, man, and I'm not trying to throw shade on you all, but you got to think that the Eagles are winners in getting the Heisman Trophy winner on their team, an ex-teammate of Jalen Hurts, who was a quarterback at Alabama. And, like, think about had they drafted Justin Jefferson last year instead of Jalen Reagor, bro. Like, they wouldn't have – they possibly wouldn't have had to draft Smith this year if they had just taken Jefferson last year. But mm-hmm. they got the Heisman Trophy winner. They did give up a little bit of draft capital, but I feel like that guy's going to have a long career in Philly. Richie alluded to the DeSean Jackson, and that guy made a career out of just beating the teams in that division. Mm-hmm. So, and this guy can run more routes than what just that go route that DeSean Jackson had. So I feel like Philly didn't fuck it up this year. Their fans were actually happy. I know last year they were mad as hell with Reagor and Hurts both going, you know, first and second round. I think Philly did good for themselves.
Do you guys have a loser for the draft? A team that you don't like what they did at all?
I got the Jags because they took ATN, but obviously they got Lawrence, and the Giants because they wanted a receiver and they ended up having to settle for Tony from Florida. They did trade back and they got a first round pick, but man, you got to feel like they thought maybe even Waddle and Smith were going to be there mm-hmm. for them to choose from. And they ended up getting, you know, I don't want to say like the shit end of the litter, but you know, they traded back. They got Tony, who was a playmaker for Florida, but more of a gadget guy, if you ask me, for him.
Yeah, my loser, and this is because I just never really understand what this team does, and you could really call them a draft loser for the past couple of years, is the Raiders. I have no idea what these guys do every single year. They drafted a guy named Alex Leatherwood in the first round.
Well, they always do that, dude.
There were a couple of other guys that you probably could have taken with that first round draft pick that would be a starter this year. I don't think I saw anybody project Leatherwood as a day one starter. So always just got to question what the Raiders do. So I'm just going to call them a loser, and they're probably hoping that they land Aaron Rodgers now.
What position is that guy, Leatherwood?
He's a tackle.
He's an offensive tackle from Alabama.
Oh, I was going to say, with a name like Leatherwood, you got to be a beast as defender, bro. Like,
Rich, you got any loser?
I got the Giants as my loser, dude. There's a lot of good receivers on the board, and they picked that guy. I was ecstatic that they picked that dude. So they're definitely my pick. I'm not afraid of Kadarius Toney coming up, even with the bum corners that we got. I'm not afraid of that guy.
And I'll just ask you kind of like how I asked Ben about the Cowboys. Where do you see them in the NFC East? Do you think they, with Dak healthy, they take out the Redskins? Or not the football team, excuse me?
Yeah, with a healthy Dak, I think we take the division easily.
How about the Packers for being losers? I mean, they lost Aaron Rodgers on draft day pretty much, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for a corner, right? I think they took a corner.
Another corner. They ended up taking
a corner in the first round, and they pretty much lost Aaron Rodgers. He's saying he's not going to come back. They got to be the biggest losers on draft night. You lost the MVP.
Yeah, and just speaking of quarterbacks, I thought maybe the Saints might have done something at the quarterback position, but the quarterback that they took was Ian Bock, I think, out of Notre Dame, which I don't think is going to have too much of a career. And I think they just lost Drew Brees. So they're going to roll in with Winston. So we'll see what the Saints end up doing. But I thought they would have addressed quarterback a little bit sooner than the fourth round. But that wraps it up about for the NFL, unless you guys had anything else to add before we move on to NBA for today.
I was pissed off that the Eagles took Milton Williams, a DT out of Louisiana Tech, because – one of my buddies that I know from Sherryland, I think he trains him up in Frisco. Okay. And he was telling me that his comparisons in terms of like spark scores and whatnot were up there with Aaron Donald. So he was calling him a dark horse, and he was hoping we'd get him in the third, but the Eagles swiped him from us, man. So hopefully he doesn't ball out. But look for Milton Williams, and if he balls out, then we're in trouble.
Okay, I like that. What about you, Ben? Anything else to add before we call it a day for the NFL?
Fuck the Texans. How about that? Yeah. How about that?
All right, guys. Moving on to the NBA. I think we've been talking about the NBA for at least the past 20 podcasts. It's in the full swing. We only got maybe less than 6 or 7 games left for most teams. The play-in starts on the 19th, and that's where we start today. We're going to introduce a little – a little segment here with the NBA. I know we did ballers or busts when we were talking about pretty much pretenders or contenders. We're going to do the same thing here, but we're going to call this Cap or Facts. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and introduce a topic about kind of what's going on in the NBA, and then I'm going to ask the guys to respond if they think it's cap, meaning like they're not buying it, it's bullshit, or is what I just said, am I speaking facts, for lack of better words. So the first one is LeBron James. LeBron James, he came back a couple of days ago from that high ankle sprain, probably the longest that he's been out in his career, and he finds the Lakers right on the cusp of falling into that play-in range. Now, the play-in tournament, our teams ranked, I want to say, 7 and 8 and 9 and 10. So the teams ranked 7 through 10 are going to be in a little mini play-in tournament. The NBA introduced this to kind of, you know, tell teams to not tank and give a little bit more, I guess, incentive to continue playing throughout the year. If you're not in that 8 seed, if you find yourselves in the 9 or the 10 slot, you now have a chance to make the playoffs. And LeBron James, he finds the Lakers almost in that 7 spot. And he said, verbatim, whoever came up with this idea needs to be fired. Do you think LeBron is a sour apples, or is it what he's saying facts? Is this cap or facts on what LeBron's saying right now? Is the play-in tournament bullshit, or do you like it? Do you think it adds some more competitiveness to the league, Ben? Cap or facts?
This is so much cap. If I had my cap on me, I'd be smacking that shit all over the screen, bro. Why wasn't LeBron, you know, letting these sentiments be known last year when there was a play-in game and the Grizzlies ended up getting screwed? I believe that the Blazers were the 9th seed, ended up beating them twice, getting into the playoffs, and then playing the Lakers. LeBron had no problem with it then. It just seems to be, if you find yourself in that play-in spot, if you find yourself in that 7 or 8 seed, I mean, we saw Luka complaining about it a couple of weeks ago as well when the Mavs were sitting in 7. So, listen, we saw the NFL add an extra game to make it 17 games. Now we see the NBA trying to add some extra games for views and just more opportunities for money. I'm with it. I know the players are with it, but if they're that 7th or 8th seed, then – you can't expect them to like it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And, you know, the one thing I will say, too, is I'm going to go ahead and say that this is cap, too. I don't think LeBron would be complaining if he were in the 1 seed or the 2 seed. I don't even think he would be mentioning it. But since he finds himself in that spot, he's complaining. He's trying to throw some weight around, but it's not going to happen. You saw the MLB. They added in that the play-in for the wild card. You know, it comes down to one game for some of those teams in the MLB, and that's something that they have to deal with. I like this. It adds a little bit more competitiveness. Like you said, it gets 2 more teams to continue playing rather than tanking. And, yeah, LeBron's just capping right here. What about you, Rich?
Well, I think he's capping as well. I third that notion that I think it definitely makes it more competitive. I mean, it just brings that – it's going to bring, more casual watchers in, I'm sure. Just the competitiveness in itself, and it's like a new type of deal. So I think he's capping for sure.
If there was ever a time to complain, it was last year when they were housing teams in a hostel in Hotel Prestige by the rankings, by the standings. If there was ever a time to complain, it was last year when the teams in the play-in were staying at the fucking Motel 6 at Disneyland, LeBron. All right? Not right now. So, nah.
Yeah, and LeBron looks even weirder because I think another guy who finds himself in the play-in, Steph Curry – he's come out and said he's all about it. He loves the play, and he likes that opportunity. So LeBron looking a little funny here. So we're all saying cap here. But keeping it with the play-in, I want to ask you guys, do you think that a team that finds themselves in the play-in tournament can potentially win a round in the playoffs? Let's say the Lakers find themselves in the 7th spot. Do you think they can win the play-in and win a first-round game? Or do you think the play-in guys are just in for the play-in in the first round? And we say that they're out. So cap or facts on a play-in team winning a round one series?
Facts.
Really? Okay. Yeah.
I definitely think it – I'm going to liken it to soccer in terms of form, dude. If a team gets hot, I can see them doing it. I can see them pulling off an upset.
Okay.
But is there a team maybe in mind that makes you say facts, or you just see it playing out that way just because?
I just see it playing
out. The Warriors.
I mean, Steph's playing out of his mind right now. I could definitely see him to continue to play this way, and they can pull one, at least one.
But you're saying like rolling for a team to win the play-in and then go into the first round of the playoffs and win.
Yeah.
So then it would be like them then playing the Suns and beating the Suns.
Or playing the Jazz, I guess, and beating the Jazz.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Now I go cap.
Cap.
Okay. Cap. Yeah. All cap. All caps.
I'm glad I cleared it up here.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, Richie thought you were saying, can one of the play-in teams win the play-in series?
No. I'm saying a play-in team win the play-in and then go to the round one and win that respective matchup. Yeah. I think the only team that's capable of doing that is the Lakers, if they find themselves in that spot, right?
And the seventh seed having to play the 10, right?
Yeah. Yes, exactly. And then they move on to the playoffs. I could see them winning a round one series, but that's really the only team. So for the most part, I'm going to go ahead and say that's cap. I do like that the NBA is doing it to, again, add some competitiveness, but I don't think that a play-in team will make that much noise in the playoffs. Like, everybody thought the Blazers might make some noise against the Lakers, right, getting that play-in and getting hot and Dame time, but we all saw what happened. So I think the only team that's capable is probably the Lakers, but we'll see what happens.
And out east, I mean, the one team that I thought maybe out there, like, play-in team winning to get into the playoffs. I like the way the Wizards have been playing. I like the way Westbrook and Bradley Beal have been playing. I think that right now they're sitting in the 10 seed. I think that they could possibly beat the 7 seed and end up getting into the playoffs, but I don't see them beating, you know, the 76ers or the Nets or anybody like that.
Yeah, they'd probably be matched up with the Heat or the Hornets. Those are the 7 and 8 seeds right now.
A Wizards and Hornets series would go hard.
That'd be a lot of points. It'd be like 125.
Well, but watching LaMelo and Westbrook go at it,
that'd be a nice matchup.
That'd be fun.
And speaking of Westbrook, let's have this talk here. I'm a Westbrook fan. I know Ben's a Westbrook fan. I think Rich likes Westbrook. He is going to average a triple-double for what I think is like the third or the fourth season in his career, more than any other player. He won MVP a few years ago, averaging a triple-double. You hear the words thrown out, empty stats. What do these triple-doubles even matter? Freaking Steven Adams, when he was on the Thunder, there were clips of him letting Russell Westbrook get rebounds. He's padding stats.
Stat padding rumors, yeah.
What do you guys make of this? You know, Scott Brooks went out and said that if he were to make his rankings today, he puts Russell Westbrook as the second greatest point guard of all time. Is that cap or facts coming from Scott Brooks? And Ben, you take this one. I know you like Westbrook.
I do like Westbrook. I'm not going to go as far as saying second best all time. I mean, there's always, like any other position, there's going to be the people that say he doesn't have a ring. I myself would say he's top five, just if we're looking at numbers. Let's say there's no names on the papers and we're just looking at numbers, then maybe you're going to get somebody that puts Russell Westbrook's numbers as either one or two, just based off numbers. But when there's names involved and then you could kind of see what that player did for the team, it's hard for people to agree that Westbrook is the second best point guard of all time because he hasn't had much success in the playoffs after KD has left. He hasn't won a series since KD and him haven't been teammates. So I love the guy. I like how hard he goes out, but I'm going to say that, I mean, Scott Brooks loves him. He coached him in OKC. Yep. He's now coaching him in Washington. I expect him to say that. He gives the Wizards their fight. And he's the pulse of that team. I understand why he said it. I'll say he's top five all time, but not two.
Okay. What about you, Rich?
I agree with Ben's take. He's top five. He's not top two. He's definitely not top two. I think I'd probably put Curry up there at two, in my opinion.
Yeah, I'd probably put Curry right behind Magic Johnson at two. So I'm going to go ahead and agree with you guys. I'm going to say cap. But I do want to say I have him ranked higher than John Stockton. He's higher than – I'll put him above Oscar Robertson. I'll put him above Steve Nash. Chris Paul is where it gets a little iffy for me because I'm a huge –
You'll put him in front of Steve Nash?
I'll put him in front of Steve Nash. I'll put him in front of Steve Nash.
In front of Allen Iverson?
I'll put him in front of AI all day. In front, and I love AI, but AI also, you can also make the argument he's not a true point guard. I mean, he was a 6-foot shooting guard.
AI's favorite player is Russell Westbrook, man, for a reason. So
exactly. And like Ben said, man, I mean, there's nobody else in this league that goes out with the amount of intensity that Russell Westbrook does. I've never seen a guy dunk a basketball with more anger than Russell Westbrook. Like, I love the way he plays. Yeah, things haven't been good for him in the playoffs. A lot of it is him, too, being just this ball-dominant guard that he is. But, you know, the numbers are there. Like Ben said, you take the name away, you don't look at anything else, and you just put the numbers up there. It's hard to find five guys that are better than this guy. But, you know, like Ben also said, Scott Brooks loves Russell Westbrook. They've been together for a lot of Westbrook's career.
Makes his job a lot easier, man.
Yep. So I don't see Scott Brooks saying anything else. But I did bring this up more so just to say that we need to give Russell Westbrook his flowers while he's still here. You know, I think he's one of those guys that gets hated on a lot because he does put himself out there. He wears his emotions out on his sleeve. He had this whole thing that happened with KD. He's Kyrie. He's the opposite of Steph Curry. You have Steph Curry, who's a 3-point shooting wizard with the ball, not super athletic. Then you have Russell Westbrook, who's this mean guy, takes it to the rim, super athletic, a buff guy, complete opposite. And I just feel like he gets a lot more hate than he should. Is he the greatest player of all time? No. Does he have his flaws? Yes. But is he a first ballot Hall of Famer? No doubt. You're not going to find anybody that disagrees with that. So let's just give him his love while he's here. That's more so why I wanted to talk about that.
It's like the stat padding shit. Like, nobody has averaged a triple double in this. Yeah. People used to say, oh, yeah, well, Chamberlain was doing that because he was way taller than everybody and he was playing, you know, office workers. Well, Russell Westbrook ain't playing those people, but he's putting up these numbers. Mm-hmm. You know, like, it's there. You can't ignore what's there night in and night out. The team's success, I mean, the Wizards aren't going to win a championship, but the Wizards wouldn't be in the play-in scenario if Russell Westbrook wasn't on that team. And, you know, I thought that the Rockets had won the trade when they got John Wall, but Russell Westbrook is – if the Wizards are in the 5-seed, 4-seed, he's an MVP talks. They're in the play-in game at 10, so he's not an MVP talks. That's just what it comes down to.
Speaking of MVP, this one's going to be hit close to home for me. Probably one of my favorite players of the last generation is CP3. He's getting a lot of love for MVP. People are saying, look at the moves that he's made. He's gone from the Hornets, that was a playoff contender while he was there. He helped the Rockets get to probably their highest point that they've been. They were a game away from making the finals against the Warriors. And you all know what happened with his hamstring. Then he goes to the Thunder, who everybody wrote off as being a lottery team the year that he got there. Takes them to the playoffs. Leaves the Thunder, goes over to the, I guess you want to call them the baby Suns. Everybody is waiting for the Suns to make a move. Goes over to the Suns. They're everybody's trendy playoff pick to make the jump from not making the playoffs to the playoffs this next year. And they find themselves with the damn 2-seed and fighting for that 1-seed with the Jazz. So he's gotten some MVP talks. So, guys, is CP3 a legit MVP candidate, or are we just giving him a little bit of love because he's kind of gone under the radar for the past few years? So CP3, legit MVP candidate, cap or facts?
I'm going to say facts.
Wow. Okay.
I'm going to say facts because who had the Phoenix Suns as the number one seed in the West?
I didn't.
Nobody did. And Devin Booker was on the team, right? All these past years when they weren't winning anything. Like, he clearly changed the culture of that team. He's the MVP of that team, if you ask me. Yeah, Booker might score the most points. But if they're missing Chris Paul, that team doesn't have a chance. I do think that they have a chance if they are missing Booker for a game. I'm not saying for a whole series. No, they don't have a chance there. But I do think that they can win a game with Chris Paul running the show, you know, at his tempo and all that. Bro, like you said, every team has just elevated when he's joined them. We're talking about the Phoenix Suns James Jones is their GM, fam. James Jones, LeBron's number one teammate, the dude who would hitch onto LeBron's back, jump from the Cavs to the Heat and go get title. He is the Phoenix Suns GM. The Phoenix Suns are the number one seed in the Western Conference that everybody says is a gauntlet. So Chris Paul has to be in the conversation more than some of these guys that are not in the playoffs, and somehow people are finagling them into the MVP conversation.
Who is that?
I don't want to mention names. You do the math.
I mean, they're technically in the play-in.
They're in the play-in, but we got somebody who is in the one seed that's going to beat the fuck out of them if they get in. That's what's going to happen. So you do the math on that. But just because you're the leading scorer of the NBA doesn't mean that you're the MVP, folks. I'm sorry.
So Ben's saying big facts. I like facts. That. Ben's saying big facts. What about
the
you,
the only Rich? Reason the Suns are contenders. The only reason.
I got to say Cap, dude. I think, I mean, while Chris Paul is, I agree, the main reason for this and their turnaround and why they're so successful. I mean,
we're not saying he's the MVP. Let's say there's a top five. Is Chris Paul in the five?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, in the five, definitely.
Or are we saying he's the MVP or he's an MVP top?
MVP candidate. Does he deserve to be an MVP candidate?
He's a top five candidate in my eyes. Yes. I'm not saying he's the MVP.
No. I would say he's five.
Okay. That's fair. And I'm going to go ahead and say facts. CP3 does deserve to be an MVP candidate. Does he deserve to win the MVP? No, because I don't think his numbers quite stack up to Embiid and Jokic. And they also have the win percentage to go by it. But let's just give Chris Paul some of his flowers, man. I mean, he's probably one of the clutchest players in the NBA, if you just want to talk about it, in terms of games on the line, 2 to 3 point games, something like that. Need to make a play. Chris Paul is going to make that play for you. He's going to get to his mid-range shot. You saw what he did to the Knicks out there with that three-point dagger that he hit on them. I mean, Chris Paul has done everything that he can do for this team. And like Ben said, nobody had these guys written in the top half of the seeding for the playoffs. His winning percentage with the Suns this year in clutch time is 0.656. So he's winning about 66% of the close games that the Suns find themselves in. And that's defined as any game that's separated by 5 points or fewer in the last 5 minutes. So I know that was a big talk about this Suns team. It's like, well, what happens when it gets to the nitty gritty? I think we found out CP3 is their guy. Even though you have Devin Booker, who's averaging about 24, 25 points per game, it's still Chris Paul that's taking that game when he shot.
Let's not forget who the All-Star game replacement was. It wasn't Chris Paul. All right.
It was Devin Booker.
We were throwing the pity party for Devin Booker, for Anthony Davis to step out because he was injured and had gotten voted in, and to let Booker get in. But CP3 was an all-star, not a replacement. So I get it that Booker is a younger guy, but CP3 makes that go. He really makes that go, and it's got to be the reason why they're – I mean, bro, from a lottery team to the number one team, like the jumps that teams take, fuck the expectations. They don't just pass expectations. Chris Paul wasn't just an 8 seed or a 7 seed with the Thunder. He was a 5 seed with the Thunder. You know what I mean? He's a 1 seed with the Suns. So the guy's a winner. He's just missing the big one. I don't think he'll get it with the Suns, but he's hell of a career, and he deserves to be at least top five in talks.
I like that. And this is a little bonus Capper facts. It's the last one here. I'm just making this one off the top of my head. Is and I'm gonna give Richie a chance to lead this one. Is the Spurs? The Spurs just lost Derek White. They find themselves slotted in the 10th spot. Are the Spurs? Are they gonna win a play-in game, Rich, or do you like them to stay in the play-in situation, or do they fade the rest of the year? So no. Spurs is a play-in team. Capper facts.
Oh, that is Cap, my friend. Without Derek, I don't think we make it. We're not good enough without Derek. I think Pop just needs to accept that we're not going to be able to to make a run without Derek, and he used to play the young guys more. Rudy Gay is like, I think tied for, I saw something. He's like tied for second most minutes on our squad. Like, we need to give the young guys a lot more work. So that's what I'm hoping for. I definitely say Cap. We don't have it without Derek.
Makes no sense sometimes when you look at the minutes that some of the guys are getting down the stretch. And then when you look further at the schedule that the Spurs have and these last six or seven games, it's brutal.
Yeah.
I think the only W you can maybe count them in on is against the Kings, and the Kings have been playing pretty good lately. They've been scoring with just about everybody. So you really can't even count that as a Spurs victory. But you got the Kings, the Blazers, the Bucks, the Nets, the Knicks, and the Suns to close out the year.
Sheesh.
That's the definition of brutal right there. So, yeah, I have the Spurs falling out of the playoff contention as well. So I'm going to say big Cap on that. And, Ben, do you have anything to say with the Spurs? Do you think they fall out?
I mean, they're not going to win a lot of games down the stretch, but I can't guarantee you that the Pelicans are going to win a bunch of games to take their spot. So they might still see themselves possibly playing the Lakers or the Mavs for the play-in spot, but I don't see them getting in. And I agree with you all. If Patty Mills got to take a step back, Rudy Gay's got to take a step back. Hey, don't hurt yourself. You know, maybe you can play somewhere next year, but let the young guys get in there and get some run. Lonnie Walker, to me, man, Lonnie Walker can be a difference maker. Like, when he's on, he's on. Like, when he's on, he's leading that team in scoring that night that he's on. So I feel like he deserves a lot more run. I know Joby's big on Vassell getting more run.
Yeah.
So, like, the consensus seems to be let the young guys, you know, get out there.
Yeah, I want to see Lucas Aminet get more run.
Yeah, I was gonna say I want Devin Vassell, and I want Luca, man. Luca honestly has taken a lot of he's taken huge leaps in my eyes. I would say before the season my expectations weren't great, but he's definitely changed my perception. But yeah, Pop needs to give him more run. He needs to give Devin more run. Rudy needs to stop playing so much. Rudy needs to stop playing so much. That's what I want to hammer down. Pop needs to stop. Love Rudy, man, but he's playing way too much.
And Rich, you know, before we end the NBA, you know, is there anything else you want to talk about while you have the mic, sir? NBA or NFL, soccer, anything you want to talk about?
Don't sleep on West Ham United. You know, coming in top four. For the first time, I think, in their history, they've gotten top five once. We're making a run.
Do you think Leicester's going to get out of that spot, though, Rich?
I'm saying we need – our last four fixtures are rough, but Chelsea and Leicester have a rougher run, I'd say. I could see Chelsea dropping one just because of the Champions League that they're playing in. So that's why I'm hoping they're going to drop one. But also Liverpool is breathing down our necks. They're
in form. So is Toddy.
I'm not worried about Spurs. They're gonna.
We're 1 point behind, pal.
Yeah, I'm not scared of Spurs, but I think Leicester could drop one, and I think Chelsea could drop two just because they're playing. They're gonna be playing a lot of games.
Might be resting guys. Hey, and finals prediction for NBA. Who do you have winning the title? We don't know if we'll have you on before the finals is over. So who do you have?
Who do I have winning?
With no horse in the race, who do you got?
Denver Nuggets.
Denver Nuggets. All right.
I think Jokic is
without Murray though, Rich. Come on.
It's because I want it to happen, man. He's having an MVP year. I just want him to drop ridiculous numbers and lead them to the championship.
It seems like he's a favorite to win MVP this year.
Yeah, I hope he does. He's one of my favorite players, dude.
Dope.
Nice. And Richie, where can we find you on the socials, man? I know you made a return to Twitter.
I have, dude. I've been tweeting. It's Richie DC, Richie RichieDCEE. I usually just retweet a lot of stuff. It's a lot of soccer related things. So if you feel free to hit me up. Thanks for having me on the pod, guys. It was an honor. It was a fun time.
Yeah, bro.
We might make you our official soccer correspondent. So
yeah, I love that.
Be ready for that phone call.
With some, we might have some Austin FC segments, Rich. Even if it's only like 5 to 10 minutes of podcast, we got to have our Austin FC little segment. Now that we got a new team in the MLS, you're out in Austin, obviously plugged in with the team. So that'd be dope.
For sure. Yeah, definitely, man. We could do that. Have a little update after each game. I'm about it.
All right.
All righty, sir. Well, thanks for stopping by, Rich.
Thanks, guys.
All right, Roland. So, I mean, we had some shakeup in the MMA world. We got a card coming up this weekend. Not the best card, but a little pre-game for the big Houston pay-per-view card. Now, that Houston card did take a hit. Crowd favorite, podcast favorite, I would say. Nate Diaz battling minor injuries, needed a month of postponement. So they'll be fighting in June now instead of next week. What do you think? I mean, that Houston card is still stacked enough to where I don't think that it, you know, that was going to be another 5-round fight co-main event. But, I mean, that card is pretty stacked. I don't know what the pay-per-view that they're moving this Diaz and Edwards fight to in June. I don't know who's headlining that card. But what do you think about that? Were you excited to see Nate, or can you wait another month?
I think the card's stacked enough to get it through. I'm a little sad, though, because it's a Houston card, so I never want to see something bad happen to a card that's in Texas. That's just the way I'm. If there's a card in Texas, I want it to be a banger, and that's what I was looking forward to with this Diaz and Edwards as that co-main event. But I'm looking at this more from the perspective of Leon Rocky Edwards. Guy can't catch a break. When's the last time that he's fought, man? Seriously, I feel bad for him. He can't seem to get a fight to go down. He's going to have to wait another month. I'm sure a month is nothing to Leon Edwards after he had the Cosmot fight booked and rebooked a couple of times. And then this whole thing with Nate Diaz, he seems to have caught a break. And if Edwards knows what's good for him, he's going to wait for Nate Diaz, because that's a payday and a shot at the title if he wins.
Like you said, he caught a break with his Diaz matchmaking.
He did.
He just has to wait it out. Listen, people are going to watch the fight because Nate Diaz is fighting. If you beat the shit out of him, then maybe people will find out about you. But right now, nobody knows who the hell Leon Edwards is. So you just need to sit back, relax, wait till Nate Diaz is ready. And when he's ready, you just wait for that fight, like you said. So what's that, Ro?
I was going to say, as unfortunate as it is, and the reason why I'm saying it's unfortunate is because Leon Edwards is an all-around MMA fighter.
Yep.
Right? It's fair to say he's all-around. He's a true martial artist. But what do we know him most for? A three-piece and a soda. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, for getting his ass whooped backstage by Masvidal. So, yeah, we'll see. We'll obviously touch back up on that in June when we get closer to that fight. Another fight for this week, and I think that it would have probably been the main event, I would think. Diego Sanchez, Roland, this week was kind of a trip. It was
weird.
A trip. But the UFC goes on to release Diego Sanchez. They do pay him his show and win money this event. They did pay him all of that. They paid him the Venom money, and they let him go free. The original tough champion, one of the longest career in the UFC to date. What did you think of the way all of that unfolded and all the videos that he was dropping on his Instagram? What do you think?
I'm going to keep and use the same word that I just used, although in a different context. It's unfortunate, man. It's just unfortunate to see the way that his career is kind of just taking a weird turn. And without getting into too many details, because it does kind of get a little weird, but I got to thank it to the guy that he has in his corner and that he brought into his corner a couple of years ago. I don't know his first name, but I know his last
Joshua
name.
Joshua Fabia.
Fabia. Everybody seems to say, and these are outsiders, all of the outsiders all say, we have the utmost respect for Diego Sanchez, but that guy right there, that Fabia guy, get him out. Get him out. We have no respect for that guy. And it just seems like he has Diego wrapped around his finger. And it's sad to see him go out like that. Because I think if you remove Fabio from the situation, Diego Sanchez is probably going to be fighting out at least the rest of his contract and retire under his own will. But just a weird situation all around, man. Like you said, Diego was dropping all these videos, whether or not it was helping his cause. I tend to think that I tend to think that it's not going to help his cause. I don't know. It's just we. Excuse me. Let me rephrase that. I got a little caught up. I don't think those videos helped his cause at all. The ones that he put out. It just made it a little bit. The situation a little bit more stickier. It's just like, what the heck is
rolling? And the worst part was in one of those videos, they're like, this isn't going to go up on the internet or anything. And obviously, you know, that situation where Fabio went in there and started calling out the broadcast booth, started calling out Paul Felder, John Anik, Megan Olivi, saying, hey, you know, y'all are kind of just throwing dirt on our name when we go out there. And it was in that Albuquerque fight when Diego fought in Albuquerque. And DC said that he was kind of slobbering from the mouth. But everything honestly went downhill when this Fabio guy got in his corner. You know, everybody seems to respect Diego Sanchez, but Diego Sanchez seems to be brainwashed. Or I don't know what else to call it. The dude, Fabio, seems like cult-like, bro. Like that school of self-defense. I mean, it's like those weird-ass videos that Joe Rogan used to put. When like these dudes are just touching guys on the neck or doing something, and you would put legit as fuck, legit as fuck. Like it's a joke, bro. It's a joke, and it's sad that Diego Sanchez can't see it. It really is sad. But I mean, listen, Diego Sanchez has been crazy his whole UFC career, fam. Let's not forget when he was running into the octagon yelling yes, 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 holding a cross like that. Like the dude's been on one for a minute. He just found this Fabio guy who's might be weirder than him. And man, it took a turn for the worse. And it sucks the way that it ended, especially like we said, because the UFC was still treating him good. I mean, they paid him his show money. They paid him his win money for a fight he didn't even have. It was just the last fight on his contract. So big missed opportunity. I hate the way he played it, and I hope he gets that guy out of his corner. We'll leave it on. Do you think that he'll fight for another promotion?
No,
or just the end that we've seen of Diego Sanchez.
I think this is it for Diego Sanchez. I think maybe he might find himself with the bare knuckle fighting company or BKFC, whatever that's called. But Bellator already said that they don't want Diego Sanchez, so that's the next big name. And the way that things are looking, and the video that he last released,
he started an OnlyFans. If anybody's a OnlyFans user,
yeah, I mean, hopefully he makes some money there, whatever he's losing from the UFC. But it seems like they wanted some confirmation of whether or not he had undergone any or had any neurological.
They wanted medical records. His trainer wanted medical records, and the UFC kind of took it as like, whoa, well, this is his last fight. You want his medical records. Seems like you have a lawsuit already in the works is what it kind of seems.
Let's see if there's already any pre-existing.
And Roland, to the other side, like it is his last fight with the UFC. Like shouldn't a guy be able to take his medical records with him? It's kind of like in the military. Like when I was discharged from the military, I took my medical records home with me. So whatever doctor I went to next could see it and know what the fuck was going on.
What I read was Diego and his team asked for the medical records, but then the UFC rebutted and was like, hey, can you come in for – I think they're asking him to come in for tests, or they were asking him to confirm or deny if he has had any neurological damage. And that's right. Kind of where everything cut and went loose. And
that was a gray area.
Yeah, and then he released all those videos, and then it was just like snip, snip from there. But
and obviously, it's bad for the UFC if they let him get in there and something happens to him, and then they start hitting him with these
exactly, boxes, bro, exactly. And you know that's what the Fabio guy was going to go for. I mean, that's all. You hit it the nail on the head. He needs to get that guy out of his corner, and not just for the fighting man, but just for him as a human being. He needs that guy removed from his life.
Diego Sanchez came out yesterday and said that he felt scared for his life that the UFC might come and put a hit on him, bro. Like, man, it's sad. It's really sad the way that he went out. You got to think that there also is some damage to him. Like, he's been in fucking wars.
Yeah,
he's been in the promotion for 19 years. Like,
one of my first memories as a UFC fan was watching him against Clay Guida, UFC Fight Night. That was one of my first memories as a UFC fan.
Classic. Classic. And just get off Diego, the guy he was supposed to fight, and what would have been a great fight. I mean, we've been talking about book Diego with another legend. We've been talking about book Donald Cerrone. with another older guy. Don't book him with these young dudes who are more athletic and stronger than
him. He's going to run through him, yeah.
And it finally seemed like it was going to be a pretty good matchup. I had Cerrone, you know, getting some payback. They had a nasty breakup at Jackson's, and then Diego ended up leaving Jackson's as well. They end up finding a replacement opponent for Donald Cowboy Cerrone. Alex Morono steps in, 5 days' notice. Donald Cowboy Cerrone is the favorite in this fight, I believe, around minus 170. What do you think about the replacement? Do you think Cowboy gets back on track and gets a win? Is Cowboy's career, is it about that time?
Well, we're seeing the end, for sure. And I think he's already said that he sees the light at the end of the tunnel. But I'm going to say Donald Cerrone goes out. He gets the victory. I pay a lot of attention, or I try to pay a lot of attention to the pre-fight build-ups, the videos. I know these guys put out a lot of hype videos and stuff, but the one that I watched of Donald Cerrone, it looked like his headspace was there. Before Donald Cerrone, he was like playing these topsy-turvy games. Like one fight, you can tell he's all in. He's committed 110%. He wants to kill the guy in front of him. But then on the flip side, he's like, oh, hey, man, it's just another day. It's just another walk. Right. It's another walk to the octagon. No big deal. So you saw him playing these games. And for this fight, I've granted Ben introduced it, and he said that him and Diego have some history. Diego had been talking some shit. Donald Cerrone really wanted to come in and inflict injury, and he was training like that. So Donald Cerrone is in great shape. I think he's going to get a victory.
It gave me vibes of like when he fought Perry. Remember when Perry went in, and that was kind of like, oh, well, then I'm leaving Jackson if Perry's going to be training here. And there was kind of some beef there, and he went out and taught him the lesson. I felt like that's what he was going to do with Diego. Now he gets Morono on short notice. I do think that Cowboy is going to piece him up, you know, standing up. Man, I'd love to see Cowboy retire, bro. I really would like to, even if it's just Alex Morono that you retire off of. Listen, I'm probably speaking some bullshit because it's not going to happen, but I would love to see him get a Cowboy victory, maybe even a finish, and then just call it. It'd be dope. But let's wrap it up, Roland, with, you know, one of the Valley's own and one of the only other fights that I'm interested on this card. But we got Carlos Diego Ferreira plus 150 against Gregor Gillespie minus 190. This fight does worry me based on how Carlos's last fight went with Benil Dariush. Benil Dariush was a bigger guy, and he was able to wrestle Diego, kind of just sit in Diego's guard, win the position battle. Now, Gillespie is a way better wrestler than Dariush was. We saw Gillespie get knocked out by Kevin Lee, and that wasn't something that we expected. I think Gillespie's going to go heavy into wrestling just because of what he saw Dariush do. The question is going to be whether Gillespie has the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu defense that Dariush did, because we know that Dariush is very decorated in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and Diego did have him in some positions where he possibly could have gotten a sub, but Dariush was just that experienced. I don't like the matchup for him, man, but I'm going to be rooting for Diego. Probably won't be putting any cash on him, but I'm pumped for the fight. I just hope that we can have a stand-up fight, because Diego can get comfortable sitting in guard and trying for a submission, you know, as prestigious as he is in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. But it's just different in MMA, where there's punches and guys that just go for position. So that does worry me, but I will be rooting for him.
Yeah, and all of the points that you brought up are all reasons for concern when you're looking at possibly betting this fight or betting on Diego Ferreira against Gregor Gillespie. But I'm going to go ahead and say, you know, I like Diego here to get back on track. I do think he has the opportunity to get him by submission. As you said, he did have Dariush in some positions. And Gregor Gillespie, I want to say, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I want to say he's one of those guys that has a little bit of the hype train behind him in the MMA world, right?
He was just a big wrestler, and everybody just loved his wrestling prestige. And honestly, in MMA, the easiest guy to get behind is a wrestler, because if you get the fight to the ground, Gillespie isn't a guy that finishes fights. He just controls position. You know what I mean? Lays and prays, some would say. I just hope that Diego can pull something off his back. Honestly, though, bro, I do see him being on his back for a good majority of this fight. It worries me because that is the way that he's lost fights. Just really hoping he can pull off a submission here.
Well, shoot, let's root at home, man. I'm hoping he gets back on the winning streak. I mean, he had a pretty good streak going before he lost his last fight. So I want to see him get back on the winning side of things. And I think this is a pretty interesting matchup for him. And I think he stepped in, right? He stepped in for somebody because this was not the original matchup for Gregor Gillespie.
I honestly don't know. Could be he did only start promoting this fight 4 or 5 weeks ago, bro. So possibly. Yeah.
So it says Gillespie was supposed to fight Brad Riddell.
There you go.
But he backed out because of COVID-19.
So Diego looking to stay active and get that bad taste out of his mouth with that loss from Dariush. We'll see how it goes, man. That's all I got. Next week, we will have a bigger MMA portion due to the pay-per-view. Maybe get a guest or two on to talk about the fights. We're going to have a new champion in the 155-pound division, not named Khabib Nurmagomedov. So next week will be big in MMA. I know that we're pretty much going to have the picture set for the playoffs, hopefully next week as well.
Oh, yeah. And that play-in game, too.
Right. So big podcast next week. Justin will be back with us next week. He couldn't be with us today. He's good. Everything's good with Just. He'll be joining us next week. So, but that's all I got, bro. I'm about to get some dinner after this. Maybe play a game of the show.
There we go. Yeah, I'm about to get some dinner myself. And, yeah, man, I'm in the heat of a playoff championship right now. So hopefully these next few days go in my favor. For the fantasy basketball championship. I don't know if it was we talking about sports, but I know it was a league that you were the commissioner in.
Pretty much was a week. But Roland, I was in playoffs in two leagues, and bro, like, how frustrating has it been the way that these NBA stars have just not necessarily all the stars, but how frustrating has it been with the players that are going to be playing for the teams in the NBA? It seems guys are getting scratched night in and night out. You got teams just sitting half the roster to tank.
You got the teams sitting to tank. Like, you got the guys like the Pistons. Like, so, for example, the guy that I was playing or the guy that I'm playing right now, he took the route of going with all these Pistons players because, A, you got all these guys getting benched, and, B, the Pistons play 5 times this week, which is the most out of any of the teams in the NBA this year. But, I mean, he's put his team with, like, Sadiq Bey and Isaiah Stewart, who – shot his field goal percentage, so he almost had no chance of winning field goal percentage now. But it's super frustrating, man, especially because the NBA is known for late scratches. Like, they'll scratch a player 30 minutes before tip off. You have your whole lineup set, and then you got guys out. But what's even more frustrating is when there's multiple guys on your fantasy lineup that are out. I know you had this problem. I've had this problem some nights where you're just struggling to find games. Like, you're trying to get games on your roster, but you just can't because you have 3 or 4 guys who are out because of COVID, tanking. They're nursing little injuries. It's been ultra frustrating this year. And
maybe you don't want to drop a guy, but you have to because you got to get the game in, and you hope that you can just pick him up after the dude you pick up plays his game. You drop him again. It was shit this year, man, with the NBA. Like, the shortened season and as many games in that shorter season or whatever it may be, guys that drafted Anthony Davis, LeBron James, like, you know,
they're out of
James,
it. Yeah.
James Harden, down the stretch, man, it really hurt fantasy basketball. That did suck a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you had to get lucky. And honestly, I was kind of lucky. I did have some injuries. Like, I had SGA, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. He went down right before the playoffs. But that was really my big blow. Right now I just got to deal with Christian Wood. Hopefully he's able to go. But yeah, man, that's all I'm going to be plugged in on. That ends on Sunday. So from here till Sunday, that's all I'm going to be looking at. So, fantasy.
I'm rooting for you, bro. I'm rooting for you.
Yes, sir. We're going to try and bring it home, and that's it, man. I mean, we've talked about sports for a good 2 hours. So I'm ready to talk about some more sports next week though.
All right, bro. Well, that's it. That's it for us. Episode 42 in the book.
What are we even talking about?
We're talking about sports, baby.
I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice. I mean, listen, we're talking about practice. Not a game, not a game, not a game. We're talking about practice. Yeah.
not a game, not a game.
Me. Bam, bam. Me, man.
Not a game.
Slap that like she scored 30.
We talking about sports. I mean, what we even talking about, man? We talking about sports here.